Hello students, welcome to part 2 of the chapter Basic Mechanisms of Inflammation. In today's session, we are going to learn the pathogenesis and basic mechanisms of inflammation. Before we understand the changes in inflammation, let us first understand the normal scenario. So here in blue, you see an intact skin. And beneath that, I have shown mast cells in brown and the dendritic cells in yellow. As soon as this layer of defense in the form of skin gets breached, the dendritic and mast cells have a role in immune response by activating helper T cells. Between the cells is the interstitial fluid. Below, I have denoted the capillaries as two blue lines. The walls of the capillary show presence of endothelial cells, which I have denoted here. So the nutrients, oxygen brought by the blood in the capillaries diffuses across the endothelial layer that is joined by tight junctions into the interstitial fluid. From the interstitial fluid, it reaches to the cells. So here, the body system is not intruded by a foreign body. This is a normal scenario. Now let us understand what happens when the defense is intruded by a foreign body. Now consider this case, there is a breach of the barrier, that is the skin. Bacteria has entered into the interstitial fluid. As soon as the skin layer is breached, the cells in this layer release chemokines. These chemokines activate mast cells. The mast cells in turn release histamine. This histamine acts on the endothelial cells of the capillaries and causes them to separate out or expand. So they are now no longer joined by end-to-end junctions, but they will have sufficient space in between them to allow passage of large molecules, like say for example neutrophils. The dendritic cells are the antigen presenting cells. They bind to the antigen or bacteria through specific receptor which is present on their surface and then present them to the T cells. Now the endothelial cells have larger gaps in between them and there is vasodilation. So because of that, there is more blood flow to this particular region. So that is the reason why redness develops at the site of inflammation. Also because the capillaries are dilated in this particular region, there is more fluid accumulation. So there is swelling, which is another characteristic of inflammation. So that's how you exactly know that that part is inflamed, because there is swelling, there is redness. So now let us just understand these mechanisms in greater detail. So this process of inflammation proceeds at two levels, that is vascular stage and cellular stage. So let us now first understand the vascular stage. The vascular stage is basically characterized by the change in the small blood vessels of microcirculation. So what exactly happens? So as soon as you get a wound or a cut, there is momentary vasoconstriction. Now this momentary vasoconstriction lasts for about 4 to 5 seconds. Following this vasoconstriction, there is something called as the vasodilation. Now this vasodilation is mediated by release of histamine, which increases the spaces between the endothelial cells and causes the release of nitric oxide. This nitric oxide is responsible for vasodilation. Now an outcome of this vasodilation is that there is swelling due to fluid accumulation. And also the viscosity of the blood in this region is increased. Now why does it increase? Because there is more blood flow and more RBC. So because of the increase in the content of RBCs, you will see that the viscosity increases. The vascular events are further of two types. First is hemodynamic changes, and second is the changes in vascular permeability. Let us first understand what we mean by hemodynamic changes. The hemodynamic changes are the changes pertaining to the blood flow. So, when there is transient vasoconstriction, which is the first step that occurs as far as the hemodynamic change is concerned, this vasoconstriction is in response to a mild injury, and this lasts for about 3 to 5 seconds. And after that, you have something called as a progressive vasodilation, which is the second step of hemodynamic change. Now, this mainly occurs in the arterioles, which are the smaller blood vessels, that is the smaller blood vessels that carry the oxygenated blood. And there is an increased volume of blood in the microvascular bed because there is vasodilation. And the flow of the blood in this region is hindered or slowed due because of high viscosity. So let us understand what is high viscosity with the help of the next slide. So there is vasodilation and you have increased flow of blood to the region that has undergone dilation. So in this region you have a higher concentration of red blood cells. So as the concentration of red blood cells increases, the viscosity of the blood also increases. Now, because the viscosity of the blood increases, the flow of the blood slows down. So, this process of slowing down or stasis is the next important change that you find at the site of inflammation. Now, in addition to that, you have something called as a leukocyte margination. It means the leukocytes will orient along the vascular endothelium, or they will move towards the walls of the capillaries. Now, how exactly this process takes place, we will understand in the next slide. But this process of moving along the walls of the capillaries or along or between the endothelial cells is also known as emigration. So, emigration means what exactly happens? Let us understand this with the help of this slide. So, in the first image, if you see, this is the capillary, you have the endothelial walls, you have the plasma compartment and the cellular compartment. Now, cellular compartment means the cells you can see are flowing at the center, and surrounding that is the plasma. Now, the cells are flowing through the capillaries in one central stream. Now, in the second image, if you observe, you will see that the cells are moving closer to the walls of the capillaries. Now, this happens because once there is inflammation, the histamine is released. So, what this histamine does is it increases the gaps between the endothelial cells. Now, as the gaps between the endothelial cells increase, the plasma tends to leak out from the flowing blood. Now, this plasma which leaks out, because of that, the plasma component decreases and the cellular component increases. So, because the plasma component decreases, the cells tend to move closer to the walls of the capillaries, that is closer to the endothelium. So, this process of moving along the margins of the capillary is margination. And because they are moving closer to the walls, this process is referred to as emigration. Because once they move closer to the walls, they squeeze between the spaces and move out of the capillaries. So far we have understood hemodynamic changes. Let us now understand the second step in vascular changes. This include alteration in vascular permeability. Now, in a normal scenario, the fluid balance is maintained as follows. The capillary contains blood, which in turn contains plasma, which contains plasma proteins. These plasma proteins are like a solute. So fluid from the interstitial fluid tends to flow inward, that is towards the capillary. Now this flow is
because of colloid osmotic pressure. On the other hand, some trace amount of proteins are also present in the interstitial fluid. So this pulls some fluid from the capillary towards the interstitial fluid. This pressure is called hydrostatic pressure. Now in normal cases, there is always a balance between the colloid osmotic pressure and hydrostatic pressure. However, in certain cases, the hydrostatic pressure increases, for example, in congestive heart failure. So there is increased amount of fluid which moves out of capillary into the interstitial fluid. There is fluid leakage, which is also called as transudate. So in case of inflammation, there is increased endothelial spaces. Why? Because histamine increases the gap between the endothelial cells. So because of that, what happens is this excess of fluid leaks out. And because it leaks out, what happens is the plasma proteins, they are out into the interstitial fluid, and because of that, we find that there is leakage of large amount of fluid into the interstitial fluid. Let us understand the process in the subsequent slides. So as I had mentioned, in some conditions like congestive heart failure, the pressure balance is not maintained. That is, there is increased hydrostatic pressure. That is, the fluid flows from the capillary into the interstitial fluid. So this process is called transudate. Now in case of inflammation, if you remember, histamine is released. This histamine acts on the endothelial cells of the capillaries, and it increases the space between the endothelial cells. So because this space is increased, along with the fluid, the plasma proteins also leak out of the capillaries. So this process is called exudate. So this phenomenon is seen in case of inflammation. So now let us understand what exactly increases the vascular permeability. So the first thing could be, the space between the endothelial cells of the capillaries can increase if the cell contracts. So look at the first image wherein I have shown the contraction. So if it contracts, then in that case there is some space at the edges which increases. From there, the leakage of fluid and plasma protein takes place. The second mechanism is when the endothelium swells. So what happens is, because of the swelling, there is bulge at the center, whereas at the edges, that is towards the edges, the cell retracts. Because it retracts at the edges and bulges at the center, you will see that at the edges there is a gap which is created from where the fluid and proteins leak out. And the third possibility is when there is an endothelial necrosis or death of the cell. So when there is necrosis, then in that case the cell shrinks, and because it shrinks, the excess of fluid flows out. So these are the three mechanisms by means of which this vascular permeability increases or gets altered, because of which the loss of fluid and plasma proteins tend to take place. So far we have learned about the vascular events. Let us now understand the cellular events. So the cellular events in the mechanism of inflammation include, first, exudation of leukocytes, and second, phagocytosis. Let us now understand the exudation of leukocytes in greater detail. So in the image labeled as step 1, you can see a normal flow. So in the normal flow, you can see the plasma compartment, which is the liquid compartment denoted in light color, flowing through the capillary, and the cells which are in the form of small circles, colored circles that you can see in this particular step 1. So that is the cellular compartment. Now look at step 2. What you will find is, as there is inflammation, there is loss of the
plasma, it drains out through the gaps between endothelial cells. So because of the loss in plasma, the cellular compartment becomes more dominant. So these cells which are flowing from the center now suddenly get aligned towards the edges, that is closer to the walls of the capillary, and slowly they begin to adhere to the capillary walls. So look at the step 3. So as soon as they approach the walls of the endothelium, they begin to roll along the wall. So they adhere first, that is adhesion takes place of these cells, which includes leukocytes and other mediators of inflammation. They adhere to the endothelial cells, they roll along the gaps between the endothelial cells, and then they permeate through the endothelial margin into the interstitial fluid. So in step 3, the rolling and adhesion is denoted in the form of leukocytes, and in step 4, if you see that once they adhere and they roll along the gaps, they are out of the capillary into the interstitial fluid. So you can see the leukocytes in step 4, that they have permeated through the endothelial walls and they are now outside the capillary. So this process is called emigration and diapedesis, and this is a very classical process which is seen in inflammation. Now in the last slide, we saw the movement of some cells including leukocytes towards the interstitial fluid from the capillary by the process called diapedesis and emigration. Now what directs this movement? So this movement is guided by a process called chemotaxis. So some chemicals are released by bacteria which have intruded the cells or by damaged cells, and in response to these chemicals, the leukocytes, they move or migrate. So because this movement is directed by the release of chemicals, it is called as chemotaxis. Some of the examples of chemicals that are released include leukotriene B4, C5a and C3a, cytokines and interleukins. The next important process in cellular events is phagocytosis. Now the process of phagocytosis is basically the engulfment of solid particulate matter by phagocytes. Two types of cells are mainly involved in this process, that is polymorphonuclear neutrophils and macrophages. And this process is accomplished by these phagocytes by release of some proteolytic enzymes like lysozyme, protease, collagenase, elastase and lipase. Now the process of phagocytosis proceeds in three steps. Step 1, recognition and attachment. Step 2, engulfment. And step 3, the killing and degradation of the bacteria or microbe. Now let us understand the process of recognition and attachment. Suppose you have a cut or a wound. So now the area that is affected, the cells which are not damaged in that particular region, will release some chemicals which are also called as chemokines. So these chemicals will activate some macrophages which are present in the body. Now these macrophages will express certain receptors. One example of some surface receptors present is Fc receptor. So these receptors will bind to opsonins which are present on the surface of microorganisms. These microorganisms are the ones that have intruded through the specific cut or wound. So this particular surface receptors which are there on the macrophages will bind to opsonins which are present on the surface of microorganism. Now once they bind, a bond is established between the bacteria and the cell membrane of the phagocytic cell. So this process is what you call as the recognition and attachment. So whenever there is a cut or a wound and then there is intrusion of a microbe, then the first step is there is activation of macrophages through release chemokines. There is binding of macrophages to the microorganism, and this occurs through surface receptors which are present on macrophages, and opsonins which are present on the surface of microorganisms. Now once the bacteria attaches to the phagocyte, the next process is the phagocyte gives out long pseudopods which completely engulf the bacterial particle. Now this is mainly through activation of actin filaments by the phagocyte. So it engulfs through the release of pseudopods. Now once the bacteria is completely engulfed by the phagocyte, then the phagocyte releases some proteolytic enzymes and it causes degradation of that particular bacteria. So in this way the process of phagocytosis is completed. So that's all about the inflammation for this session. In the next session we will understand what is the outcome of inflammation and what are the mediators of inflammation. So we'll understand the different chemicals and the cells that are involved in an immune response.